I fix some cheeseburgers. Take them up there to him. And he really enjoyed them. But that was the last meal. And that was on a Sunday night.
Do the chairs in your parlor seem empty and bare? Do you gaze at your doorstep and picture me there? Is your heart filled with pain? Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear, are you lovesome tonight?
The cause of death is cardiac arrhythmia due to undetermined causes.
I wonder if you're lonesome tonight. You know, someone said the world's a stage and each must play.
He deteriorated quite rapidly. You can't ingest all he ingested and not deteriorate rapidly.
Loved you at first glance.
He just said, you know, the input's got to be just as great as the output. And that was his rational for, you know, eating the way he did.
Then came Act Two. You seemed to change. You acted strange.
He said that's the only thing he got any enjoyment out of was eating. And he liked his food real rich.
Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear. Are you lonesome tonight?
We are about 3 miles up the old South Tiller Road from the Elvis Presley birthplace in Tupelo, squirrel hunting. Elvis probably ate some squirrels as a boy because his family would have all been hunters. It's just part of your culture. You develop a taste for them, and most of the people around this area did at one time in their life eat it. It was a pretty good sustenance for their meals. Squirrels, rabbits, deer, living off the land.
The squirrels seem to be a little bit shy today. They know there's somebody down here that's looking for them and wanting to eat them.
Elvis lived across the highway about 2 blocks from where I live now. They were poor, and his daddy worked some at different jobs, and his mother worked different jobs. And people in Tupelo would sort of look down their nose at us. They thought they was somewhat higher class or better than we were. It was during the Depression. We were all poor. Everybody was poor. And my father and mother had the grocery store, and they would let people have groceries on a credit. He helped everybody, you know, to have where they would have food to eat.
Anybody home?
Yeah.
We got meat once a week, we done good. We eat vegetables during the week. Usually fix one or two vegetables and a pan of cornbread or a pan of biscuits for a meal. Now, after I married into the Presley family, now they killed rabbits, squirrel, and deer occasionally. And we raised our own hogs and killed them, and they killed possum and sweet potatoes. They loved them.
Well, his father had altered a check for some cattle, and he got sent to the Mississippi State Penitentiary and served some time. But Gladys would take Elvis, and they would go see Vernon when he was in prison. They move from out here in East Tupelo over what we, in those days, we called it shake rag. Mostly black people and poor white people lived over there.
Out on the farm, Jubilee Hawk.
Elvis was a livery boy. That's what he was. He had his guitar mostly everywhere he went to, hanging on his shoulder. Sure did.
We eat soul food. Most black peoples eat soul food. We would rid off of pig feet, fat bag meat, and salmons, cornbread, turnip greens. And this is what Elvis ate because he lived in this area most of the time. And his friends was black. It rained. Oh, this is what we was reared on. Pig feet and pig ears and greens. No place to go. The pig feet, you have to wash them in real good and put them on the stove and let them cook about 3 hours. It would take them a long time. The greens, you wash them, get the worms and bugs off them, you let them cook. Summer for about an hour or so. And this was a meal. Sometimes we didn't have no meat, but we ate just cornbread and greens. We do love chitlins. we would kill the chickens off the yard and cook chickens for a lot of time when the preacher was coming and having big dinners, and the preacher would come and eat up all the chicken, and we just eat the foot and the feet, chicken feet. That's all we had to eat after the preacher got through. He always went to church. He loved gospel music. And whether his parents went to church or not, he always went to church too.
Would you like to see my chocolate raspberry cake? Okay, here's my chocolate raspberry cake right here.
Morning service was over, we'd go outside and fix tables, and everybody would eat, and everybody'd bring their dishes. You fancy dishes, usually, you know, like you'd fix for Sunday dinner, chicken dressing, chicken and dumplings, stuff like that. Everybody'd gather in and spend the day, have a full day's service, and then we'd, about 1:30 we'd go back inside and have singing and whatever for the afternoon, and then Elvis would sing, Gladys and Vernon sang, my husband sang, they all sang together.
Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along.
We thank you, Lord, for this food today that we're about to partake of. We pray, Lord, that you will bless it and take it to the nourishment of our bodies, and then use our bodies for your service. For we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen.
And night is as black. There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me. Oh, Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, my Lord, no trouble I see.
Well, the Presley family left Tupelo to come to Memphis because they wanted to sort of better their status in life, and there were jobs here, and down in Tupelo at the time in 1948, jobs were very scarce to come by. Shortly after the Presleys arrived here, they moved into Lauderdale Courts, which is a housing project, and during the time they were living there, I, for instance, was living in a poor neighborhood in South Memphis, and we sort of looked down on the people in the housing projects. You know, they were sort of what we call the poor white trash.
I worked hard all of my life, baby. Tired of being sheltered.
Making one of the meals that Elvis would have eaten when he attended Hume's Junior High School. This is Sloppy Joe. This is one of his favorite meals.
Well, this might sound like a very cheap amount of what it cost to eat at the school, but we had to pay 25 cents for lunch. But that was a lot of money for us in those days. And the way you got it was you cut grass and you picked up cans and you brought in bottles for deposits and you did every kind of way in the world to hustle that money up so you'd have school money because basically your family didn't have it. Elvis, when he was at Humes High School, for instance, the story goes that he was kicked off the football team because of long sideburns, but that's not true. And I talked to both of the football coaches, and he came to both of them the same day and told them, Coach, I'm quitting the team because I'm hungry. And the reason I'm hungry is because I used to work after school to make my lunch money, and now playing football after school, I don't have a job. When I don't have a job, I don't have money. When I don't have money, I don't eat. And so I got to leave.
When I was driving a truck, every time a big shiny car drove by, it started me sort of daydreaming. I always felt that someday, somehow, something would happen to change everything for me, and I'd daydream about how it would be.
Elvis graduated, I think it was June the 3rd of 1953, but it was July of 1954, a little over a year later, that That's All Right Mama came out and he became locally a big star. Elvis loved hamburgers, as everybody well knows, and basically with cheeseburgers, you know, that was the luxury of having the extra thing on the condiment on your hamburger and everything. So when he became rich and everything, despite the fact that he could get caviar and pheasant under glass and everything, he never lost that affinity for the cheeseburgers that he had and that he didn't have as a child. And he would pig out on them. I've been
Well, Elvis came in here, and he came in at night. He had on overalls and a jumper and a cap. No one knew him. He ate hamburgers, mustard, pickle and onion, order of fries, and a milkshake.
Hi, this is Elvis Presley. I guess the first thing people want to know is why I can't stand still when I'm singing. Some people tap their feet, some people snap their fingers, and some people just sway back and forth. I just sort of do them all together, I guess. Singing rhythm and blues really knocks it out.
In the summer of 1956, when I was the cub reporter for the Memphis Press Seminole, one of the senior reporters on the paper, Elton Wisenhunt, asked me if I would accompany him to the home of a singer who was very, very popular with girls, and he said, I need a girl to tell me why this man is so popular. Well, we went into a middle-class section of Memphis with new homes, new ranch-style homes. I looked to my left, and I saw all these Cadillacs, which was quite unusual in that neighborhood. And the door was opened by a black maid who was dressed in a uniform. And she introduced herself and said, I'm Alberta, please come on in, but Elvis is having his dinner. It was obviously more important to him than talking to the press. We could hear a low voice saying, pass me some more of that gravy, give me some of that bread. Gladys was very chubby then, and probably she loved standing at the stove and making him these peanut butter and banana sandwiches that were fried in butter. if food is love, that's what Gladys was serving him, and I think she probably had a few herself as she was giving them to Elvis. Certainly looked it.
He liked that country living, and they always wanted a kind of like a big plantation, and that's what it really was. They wanted the animals. As I look back on it now, it's almost like the Beverly Hillbillies, because there was this big mansion here in Whitehaven, and there was horses and donkeys and chickens, and we even had a pig there for a while, and I got very close to the pig, and then one day I asked where he was, and my stepfather said, "We're eating him."
He had a situation where literally everybody was at his beck and call. And so as a consequence, we had a staff of cooks that on a continual basis took care of everything. So you didn't have to really, I mean, he'd call down and get something anytime he wanted. It was like his own short order house. It was his house and it was his, and so he could do anything he wanted to.
My name is Mary Jenkins, and I was Elvis Presley's cook. I was at Graceland for 26 years. The first day I seen him, I called him Mr. Elvis. And that's all I ever called him. But lots of people tell me now, say, "I never seen nobody to cook as quick as you can." I say, if you had to work for Elvis Presley, you would have cooked as quick as I can. He wanted it brought up there right away. He would sit out in the den sometime and eat, and then he'd eat at the dining room table. But most time upstairs in the bed, we'd carry his trays up there to the bed.
Move up, sucker, move up! Move up! Come on, we need to move up too. We need cover.
Come on, get out. Come on, get out. 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 Get
out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. The end of everything. Stopped it all.
Now, breakfast foods. Being a food service specialist, one important meal that you all are going to have to learn to deal with is breakfast foods. The soldiers are depending on you, as food service specialists, to ensure that they get a well-balanced, nutritious, and satisfying breakfast meal. Standardization. And that's the most important part of your Armed Forces recipe cards, is to ensure standardization. And the same thing, like for instance with McDonald's, Burger King, if you were to get a Whopper at Burger King here at Fort Lee in Virginia, if you were to go to California, shouldn't you get Whopper taste the same? Okay, all right. Anybody had a chance to taste some cream beef?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Cream beef has been around in the Army for a long time, a very long time. Matter of fact, some of you may know it as SOS. And we won't go into what the SOS, but it's been around. All right. And matter of fact, I would be surprised if some of the soldiers from a long time ago, such as maybe one of your favorites, rock and roll Elvis Presley, he probably too enjoyed eating cream beef. All right. That's the cream beef.
Don't that look yummy?
Mm-hmm. Right. Fit for a king. Fit for a king here.
This girl that I love so fine. Will she touch my hand? Oh, what a chill I got. Her lips are like a volcano that's hot. I'm proud to see that she's my buttercup. I'm in love. I'm all shook up.
War den jungen Dürkheimern sogar unsere Kamera völlig wurscht und die deutsche Weinkönigin feierte ihren ersten großen Triumph. München hatte seinen ganz großen Tag. 350.000 Schaulustige sahen den großen...
Elvis, did you like the food over there, outside of the army, when you would go out, you know? Did you like that type of food?
I never went out.
You never ate out at the restaurant?
I never ate in a restaurant the entire time I was in Germany. It's funny. I either ate in the mess hall or at home. I suppose the biggest thing of all is the fact that I did make it. I made it just like everybody. I mean, I tried to play it straight, you know, like everybody else. All in all, it's been a pretty good experience, you know.
Okay, we're going to start it. This is not part of the questioning, but did you get the black eyed peas when you got home?
I haven't eaten anything yet.
Haven't eaten anything?
No. I've just been looking around more or less since I've been back. You know.
Maybe I didn't treat you quite as good as I should have. Maybe I didn't love you quite as often as I could have. Little things.
He was an only child who was shepherded literally all his life, and it took a big underpinning out from under him. Really, really. It wasn't good. He never really got over it.
We know your family status has changed since you went into service. Are you going to keep Graceland? Do you have plans of moving away from Memphis, or what?
No, sir, I have no plans for leaving Memphis.
That morning when I walked into the dining room, I spoke. I said, good morning. He said, good morning. I said, what are we going to have for breakfast this morning? He said, fried peanut butter and banana sandwich. And I looked at him. I said, what? He said, fried peanut butter and banana sandwich. I said, I never heard of it. The first time I went in, fixed the sandwich and put it on the tray and brought it back, that wasn't right. His father was sitting there, and he said, Mary, I'm going with you and help you. And let's see, maybe both of us can get it right. I said, okay. And he said, let's toast the bread first. So we toast the bread and then spread the peanut butter on and slice the bananas and put on it and put them into the skillet and kept turning them with the spatula and turn them till they got heated all the way through. Then I take them and cut them, put them on the platter and take them back to me. And he said, that's what I want, that's right. And then smile.
Scatter, yeah. He was, that was Elvis's pet monkey. He'd create madness around that house because he was always chasing the women, looking up the skirts, pinching their butt. And he'd sit at the table with us and eat sometimes. And he had pretty good table manners.
Well, he'd drink milk, and he'd eat bread, and we'd give him lettuce, and he would eat most anything you carry out there to him. And I never did go inside, because one girl went in there to feed him, and he jumped on her and got her down, and another girl, I wouldn't go in there still, but one of the other girls worked there, went in there and got him off of her. No, I was afraid of him.
I'm thinking in terms of, I'd like to do a little more of a serious role, you know, because my ambition is to progress as an actor, you know, which takes a long time, a lot of experience.
Monsieur, you there in that elegant restaurant, what is the pièce de résistance? Something delectable, to be sure, something French, something ultimate in cuisine.
Well, Elvis was not a person who went out to eat. Even up to the time he died, he didn't. He just didn't do it. He just didn't, you know, he didn't want to go through the trauma of it, and he just didn't want to, you know, go out and go through the whole routine. In the South, you ate a lot of sandwiches and cornbread and,
these things. And he always ate with your hands. I mean, because, you know, he would eat even tomatoes, he would eat with his hands because he was used to doing it. He never cut them up, you know. I remember when he started eating steaks, we'd have to cut his steak up because he had never cut a steak up. He didn't know how to do it.
It's the taste that tells.
Los Angeles, Hollywood, there's a snobbery attached to restaurants. There's a snobbery attached to dining out. And, of course, you know, we eat with a knife and fork. But since he, I guess, grew up without using utensils, knives, forks, spoons, he might have had to have been kind of taught to adjust to that. But I think that if he had had the right sort of mentors, if he'd had people that would have said, you know, Elvis, we've got to open up your world here. Everything doesn't have to be, you know, peanut butter and banana and jelly sandwiches, boiled okra. Let's have, you know, a lovely fillet of sole, Dover sole, flown over from Dover in England.
He wouldn't eat fish. Elvis hated, he would not eat fish at all. He hated fish. And he just didn't like it. Didn't like the smell of fish.
Los Angeles. He ever called me and told me, he said, Mary, I want you to catch the first thing coming this way. He was unhappy with it, but he couldn't do no better because them people out there really can't cook.
The constant thing with Elvis was no change. He always stayed the same. He was this way, he stayed that way. He didn't like change.
If he wanted them in the morning when he woke up, I would have to fix them. If he wanted them at 2 o'clock in the morning, I would have to still fix them for him. Whenever he get a taste for them, he'd call down and that's what he wanted. Well, yeah, I imagine that hoped to make him heavy because he wanted them real rich.
You look like an angel. Walk like an angel.
Elvis, what made you decide to go back to doing live concerts?
I just missed it. I missed the closeness of the audience, of the live audience. So just as soon as I got out of the movie contracts, I started to do live performances again.
My duty was a personal aide, but my job was to make sure that the food was there when he wanted it, cooked the way he wanted it, and that room service was open 24 hours a day. He just said, Billy, you know, the input's got to be just as great as the output. But what he meant by that was, since he's working so hard, he should be able to eat just like everybody else, you know, to keep up his strength to do these shows. And that was his rationale for, you know, eating the way he did. Had a tremendous appetite. As you get older, your metabolism slows down, so I'm sure it was harder to lose the weight.
I'm Dr. George Nikopoulos. I was Elvis's doctor for approximately 10, 12 years. One of the things that I kind of felt responsible for was his weight gain and trying to figure out ways for him to exercise and lose weight, which he really wasn't interested in most of the time. And having him on the road, we could control his food better than we could at home.
Because they had him on a strict diet one time, had food coming in from California for him, and sometime he would eat it and sometime he wouldn't. He said that's the only thing he got any enjoyment out of was eating, and he wanted to eat whatever he wanted. He wanted.
Without a doubt that when you grew up like that without things, and when you came into money, in particular with Elvis's sake, where he had millions of dollars, he never, all the way to the time he died, he never got over overindulging the things that he was denied as a child. And I think he did overcompensate a lot.
Elvis's whole life was built on a lot of boredom, you know. And we didn't have anything to do one morning. I called him, he was in the bedroom, and he said, what do you want to do? I said, I have no idea what sounds good. I said, why don't we go to Denver? And he said, well, let's go. And I said, fine. And there was a restaurant there that, you know, that I said, look, there's a restaurant there that fixes great peanut butter, banana, jelly sandwiches, and they make them a long loaf, and they'll cater the plane.
Scott, and this is my wife Cindy, and Elvis helped make us famous for a moment by coming to Denver on one occasion and having 22 peanut butter and jelly sandwiches delivered to his plane on the runway. It's called Fool's Gold on the menu, and it was his favorite sandwich. There's somewhere in the neighborhood of 42,000 calories in a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, most of them fat. Surprised us when he came up, had the peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and turned around and flew back. He was planning on going on tour, so there was some conversation about getting in shape and doing whatever he had to do to get there. Peanut butter and jelly wasn't one of the things
that we would recommend anyway.
You know, weight is, which I think I'm a qualified expert on, weight is one of the situations where all of a sudden you're heavy. It doesn't, you don't turn and say, oh, I'm getting heavy. All of a sudden you are. And so you try to deal with it the best way you can. You can ignore it and hope to God it goes away, and it doesn't. Or you can try to do something about it.
Lamar Bikes. He weighed about 350 pounds, but he had that operation and taking part of his stomach. Well, Last time I seen him, he was about your size.
He decided that we weren't doing any good with his diet in Memphis, so he wanted to go to Vegas and try a diet out there. And I think this diet was nothing but papaya juice. His dream was that he could, that the doctor at that could put him to sleep for 2 or 3 weeks, and he would wake up after he's been on this formula, and he would have lost 20 pounds. Turned out this formula, the juice, was so high in calories, he'd gained weight out there.
I'd say the last time I went to Vegas, it had been almost 2 months since I'd seen him, and it was like a big change. I mean, he was a lot bigger. I mean, when I walked in the room, it was almost like I didn't know who he was. Elvis was, you know, what's happening, you know, and it was just like, the show must go on.
We're at 1298 Madison, the Western Steakhouse and Lounge in Memphis, Tennessee. My famous customer was Elvis Presley. Nobody ever called him. He always had on some kind of hat or cap or sunshades, and you'd never know it was him if you didn't know it was Elvis. We got a talent contest one time, and he was just happened to be here that night. There was just one night that he was here. A lot of people come in, and you know, for the talent contest, but nobody ever knew that it was Elvis in here. Of course, my husband can talk me into anything, and he said, Elvis, would you get up and sing for us? And he said, yeah, I'll get up there and mess the whole show up, and just laughed about it, you know. And so when he got up, I thought, oh, my God, what are we going to do now if they find out it's Elvis?
And time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much. Are you still mine?
Nobody ever said a word. Gave him a few applause, you know, when he got through singing. That was about it.
But he didn't win.
No, he gave him third place.
Codeine, morphine, methacrylone, diazepam, ethinamate, ethchlorvinyl, amobarbital, pentobarbital, meperidine, amitriptyline, nortriptyline, phenyltoxylamine. When people are consuming lots of drugs, they often don't eat very well, and this is particularly true of stimulants such as cocaine and amphetamine. On the other hand, we know that Elvis, even under the impact of lots of stimulant drugs, continued to eat large amounts of food. His weight never dropped, which is common among big-time drug users. So although Elvis's appetite may have been depressed, it didn't stop his consummatory behavior, apparently.
A normal person, you'll sit there and eat, and when your stomach gets full, you can feel it. But if you're under so much medication that you can't feel pain, you'll keep eating until you burst almost. And, you know, that's not very good for you.
He had a congenital megacolon, which means that the colon enlarges because it doesn't have proper nerve supply to propulse the food through, and it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. He was sort of a borderline diabetic, so we had that to work with, plus his high blood pressure.
How many of you have dreamed of spending quality time alone with Elvis Presley? And how many of you have dreamed of lathering his coffee for him, putting in the cream and sugar and stirring it for him? And how many of you have dreamed of giving him a back rub? And I just want to tell you, ladies, right now, that I have lived your dream because I've done it all. In 1975, he was a patient at Baptist Hospital. And when I walked in the room that morning about 5 o'clock, and he smiled at me and spoke to me, then I knew he was always going to be a part of my life. Well, Elvis liked banana pudding, and he asked me one night if I knew how to make it, and I said, sure, everybody knows how to make banana pudding. So I took the banana pudding upstairs, and we had our coffee, and then when he was ready to eat, I said, are you ready for breakfast? And he said, I'm ready for banana pudding. He didn't even ask me if I wanted any. I mean, he ate it all. The next night, we went through the same routine again. And he ate every bite. I mean, I didn't even get a lick of it. He ate every bite of it. That's it. Banana pudding, anyone?
When he was in the hospital, he would call me to bring him in dipping foods. And one day he called me and told me, he says, Mary, said they have me on a diet, and I want you to slip me some hot dogs with kraut on them. And slip them, wrap them up and slip them in to me and tell them there was some clothes that you were bringing me up here. So I went on in with the bag in my hand and handed it to him, Mr. Elvis, and he looked at me and smiled. He said, Mary, we can get by them, can't we? I said, yeah, we sure can. And he opened that bag up and went to working on them hot dogs and kraut.
He was very receptive to suggestions, even when he was in the hospital. He ordered food very well. We had a dietitian that would come up and see him and see what he would eat. And he ate vegetables. You know, I read these books where all Elvis ever did was eat junk food. But I have never, ever at any point see him overindulge in anything.
I mean, he was going in there so he could get away from some of this food and stuff that he'd been eating, and we were sneaking it up to him. You know, I mean, because he'd get on me if I come up and I didn't have a sack full of cheeseburgers or something. He'd, you didn't bring me anything? No. I'll remember that when bonus time comes around. Wait a minute, I'll be right back. He just got finished eating a barbecue pizza. And he said, Billy, that was pretty good. I'd like to have another one. And I looked over at him, really just kidding with him, and I said, well, where are you going to put it? And he said, well, you're fired.
Actually, it tastes better than it sounds. it's your basic pizza with, instead of pizza sauce, we put barbecue sauce, cheese, but on top we put barbecue pork. And there you have the barbecue pizza, just like Elvis used to eat it.
This is the house that Elvis bought for me. He bought it in 1974. And he came and picked the house out for me. And I liked it. And he said, well, Mary, this is your house, if you like it. I told him I loved it. It was really nice.
What can he do now?
He was just a sweet person.
You've seen the pictures of Elvis with the coveralls on, and in his room at the foot of his bed, there was a big poster, and it was this picture. He pointed this out to me, and he said, Miss Cock, I always keep this here because I don't ever want to forget where I came from.
Never will. Get that day.
He got on collard greens one time there, and we had to fix them greens for him every day. He wanted collard greens, cornbread and collard greens.
And I always believe people come full circle.
People too.
And I saw it, it rattled me, it bothered me. That, I mean, if you use food as a thing that, you know, beginning and end, it really bothered me. I wasn't using the term as an omen, but it just didn't ring right. When for you know, 20-some-odd years, he never touched it. He deteriorated quite rapidly. You can't ingest all he ingested and not deteriorate rapidly, so. Caught up with it.
The week before he died, we were really, got him on a strict diet of mostly nothing but Jell-O made with Nutrasweet. So that he had really almost been on a starvation diet for a week.
The last thing was that cheeseburgers. Saturday night, or Sunday night, and Monday night, he didn't eat anything. I said, you're not going to eat anything for me before I go. He said, mm-mm, I ain't hungry. I just want to rest. And I said, well, okay then, night-night, and I'll see y'all tomorrow. He called me, may we. He said, well, okay, may we, I'll see you tomorrow. And that was the last time I seen him alive. That was 2:05 in the morning.
Elvis Presley died here about 3:30 this afternoon. He had been found in his bathroom, unconscious, was brought to the hospital by ambulance, and Elvis was declared dead at 3:30.
I'm Dan Warlick, and in 1977, I was the chief investigator for the medical examiner's office in Memphis, in Tennessee. Mr. Presley underwent his terminal event while he was on the commode. And in fact, his colon was impacted with a clay-like substance, which would have made it difficult, if not impossible, to have a bowel movement. And there is known to medical science a phenomenon called a maneuver in which in pressing the abdomen or pressing very hard against the bowel, you can compress the aorta and cause a cardiac standstill. So that is a possible cause of his death.
I was the one that took the sheet off of him. I looked at him, and I looked right into the face of Elvis Presley. We had three men that picked him up, so it took three of us. It was a big load. Normally, we send two men on a call to pick up a body. This time, we sent three because we did not know how big Elvis would be. We did need three men. We did not need to use but one mattress, so we took one of the top mattress out and laid him on the bottom mattress, and he was so large that he filled up the casket, and you could see him. That's the way we had him lying in a viewable state. We took the other mattress and cut it up into three sections and made pillows out of it.
Love me tender, love me sweet, never let me go. You have made my life complete, and I love you so. Love me tender, love me true, all my dreams.
I really think that Elvis staged his own death because of the fame. I think he wanted to get away from the fame. He doesn't drink anymore. And he doesn't do a lot of pills or anything like that. And I think he had to get away from those people that were surrounding him.
Love me tender, love me long.
I did meet Elvis Presley February, March, and April of 1989 in Hawaii. He was so heavy. I said, why do you want to eat all that meat? Look at me, and I had such a thin waist at the time. And he did wear the dark glasses. He said, I suggest you wear glasses too, even though people will not recognize you.
Love me true.
Older, I mean, I didn't recognize him at first. He was quite gray. Well, he's vegetarian, and I'm a meat eater, and I was like trying to, you know, throw beans together, and I fished, so I you know, would try to give him fish. He wouldn't eat fish.
Love me tender, love me dear, tell me you are mine. I'll be yours through all the years, till the end of time.
One night I was sitting there at 1 o'clock, and he came down the steps and stood right there beside of me. He said, Mary, I want to stay with you. And I told him, I said, well, you're welcome to stay at my house, Mr. Elvis. You know that. And I looked up at him, and he kind of smiled a little bit. And he vanished away.
And I always